3, 2, 1.
Okay, we will look at the fourth in the series of severe storm ingredients where we're going to focus on sources for lift. We've previously considered low-level moisture, mid-level lapse rates, and sources for vertical shear. So we need to consider lift, what that does to the storm environment, and how it's related to storm initiation specifically. So the role of lift. This is one where I think it's the scale argument, and once you become comfortable with the role of the various scales of lift, you can see how they fit into the whole process of forecasting severe storms. Synoptic scale lift primarily sets the stage for severe storm development. It's not the source of ascent that initiates most of the storms directly, and I'm going to show other examples of this later. It's mostly about, like the cyclogenesis case, differential advection, moving low-level moisture beneath steep mid-level lapse rates, and changing the profile in the vertical to where it's easier to initiate storms. But it's not too common for surface-based severe storms to be initiated directly by synoptic scale lift. Mesoscale lift, this is something like now we start talking about fronts or a dry line, and in the next session I will talk about the specific dry line case and how that works. The duration of the lift is now we're talking about many, many hours, very weak ascent. It's stronger ascent over a shorter period of time for a smaller area. And these tend to be characteristic of boundaries. And the ascent can be on an order of magnitude stronger than what you see on the synoptic scale. And these usually boundaries or terrain features are involved. And then, of course, we have the lift on the storm scale, which this is more related to pressure perturbations associated with rotating storms, that sort of thing, or even gust fronts. But that lift may be on the order of minutes, and it's partly what's related to helping maintain the storm. So specifically the supercell storms, we'll talk about that more in detail. The pressure perturbation with the mesocyclone itself helps recreate the storm over time. Okay, the comparison of the lift sources, synoptic scale lift, maybe 5-10 centimeters per second for 6 hours. In this case, you get 2.2 kilometers of vertical displacement, which is roughly the equivalent of going out here in the lower plains from about the surface to 800 millibars, that pressure surface. So the air rises about that far over a 6 hour period. That's typical of synoptic scale lift. When you have lift over broad areas like this, you should expect to see broad areas of cloud cover forming if there's sufficient moisture. And in those rare cases, you'll see storms popping up all within a broad area. Mesoscale lift, where we're talking about a front or a dry line, it's more like on the order of a meter per second for an hour or so. So just in 1 hour, you can get more than twice or almost twice the depth of ascent in a sixth the time with the typical vertical motion you see on the dry line. But these are narrow zones, and you have to make sure the storms or the potential parcels that would feed a storm stay in that zone of ascent. And I'll talk about that more later. And again, here, you won't expect to see big areas of cloud cover. They should start in little bands or small points. So how the storms originate usually tells you what the source of ascent is that is initiating the convection. And then the storm scale, those forced vertical motions can be in the order of 10 meters per second for just 15 minutes. In that amount of time, that's moving pretty fast. You can ascend 9 kilometers in 15 minutes. That's a good chunk of the depth of the troposphere. And I'll show you what happens to a sounding in if you just apply some sort of perfect world, what the ascent looks like and how it modifies the profile. So we're gonna take a sounding from Norman. This was 18Z on the day of one of the significant tornado outbreaks in May 24th of 2011. Okay, so we apply low-level ascent. This is what it looks like synoptic scale if the lift is centered down around 850 millibars. That is 6 hours of ascent at 10 meters per second, starting in the low level. So that's about what it would do to the profile. This is the kind of change you would expect to see in the profile. You see deepening of the moist layer and some weakening of the convective inhibition from below, but otherwise it's not a drastic change in the profile. Okay, so mesoscale, this is something more akin to what you'd find along the dry line. So if you go all the way from that first one to here, that's just in 1 hour. How much? Now the sounding's already starting to look pretty unrealistic. This area right here, there would already be deep convection going. So we've already reached a level of free convection well before this. So this says on that same profile, 1 hour of ascent at 1 meter per second lifts parcels plenty high enough to initiate storms. This is what happens when you apply 15 minutes of 10 meter per second ascent. Well, this is like in the core, in a mesocyclone with a supercell storm, it is drawing air in and upward, and it would modify the profile rapidly. So obviously that sort of ascent is occurring on a very small scale. This is like essentially what it looks like in the updraft of the supercell. So you don't see soundings like this. This thing does not show up in the real world. It's almost impossible to get observations that look like that. But so we're interested in the synoptic and the mesoscale changes and how that initiates storms. So the key is how long to reach a level of free convection. If you need at least 6 hours of ascent, mostly this just sets the stage in the background. We deepen the moist layer, which if you're deepening the moist layer and you think back to the mixing discussion with the moisture return, that shelters the boundary layer from mixing. If the moist layer is deepening through ascent and horizontal advection is replacing that moisture from a source region, you come up with a deeper moist layer, it's harder to mix through that and bring dry air down from aloft. So it's easier to maintain the moist layer because it's deeper. Mesoscale lift, again, 1 hour of ascent along the dry line, and then this 5 minutes and within a supercell just to draw the air up from the surface to the level of free convection. It just takes a few minutes to do that. Okay, the synoptic scale lift sources, quasi-geostrophic theory, the two biggies are warm advection and differential positive vorticity advection or cyclonic vorticity advection, same thing. We've talked a little bit about the jet streaks, the entrance and exit regions. With the straight jet, you also have ascent in the right entrance and left exit. And you could argue that's sort of a response to frontogenesis. And then we also discussed the curved jet, which just slightly reorients the vertical motion field. Here's just an example of a jet streak to show that the ascent can matter. We had a marginally severe storm in southwest Missouri. This is the ice attacks where we've got mid-level flow 80 to 90 knots. And I've drawn a streamline this down the jet core, slightly curved cyclonically, but in general, this left exit region was the only place where we had changed the thermodynamic profile and the shear profiles enough to support severe storms. And you notice there's no convection anywhere else other than way over to the east with the lead trough. So this is a case where, you know, it's hard to find these where you get storms just conveniently in the left exit region, but every once in a while it shows up. Okay, QG Omega example. I'm gonna go through two cases here just to illustrate the same things. This is just a recent case from our severe weather event in the southeastern United States on January 22nd into the overnight hours of the 23rd. This is the storms in Florida. You know, here, band of thunderstorms with some supercell structures across central Florida at the time of this analysis. This is when I got into work last night. And we have big cyclone up over the southern Appalachians, and we can see pressure trough with the surface wind shift and front. So the convection is focused on the mesoscale along the front at the surface. And let's look at what the profiles look like for the quasi-geostrophic contributions aloft. If we continue there, just to show there is buoyancy, so the reason we have thunderstorms, it is interesting that we do have surface-based cape over the Gulf of Mexico. This is an air-sea modification response. We've got the cooler, drier air coming over the loop current, very warm water, near 80 degree Fahrenheit water, even at this time of year. And if you see the little speckly convection here, there are actually some pretty strong winds. With this convection, it formed into a little band that was behind the cold front. But because we have all the heat and moisture flux off the warm eastern Gulf of Mexico, we still managed to generate some low top convection there. Okay, vertical shear, just to show you, this is the 0 to 6 kilometer shear bulk wind difference. 60 knots, this is well into the supercell range down along the front, much stronger with the jet core itself and low-level northerly winds beneath, you know, 70 to 100 knots southwest flow aloft. So it's a supercell profile given some buoyancy and vertical shear, and that's the reason we'd be interested in this case in the first place. Okay, looking at the low levels, we'll start there and we're gonna kind of look up with time and to the west. In this case, this is low-level convergence. All these graphics are available on the SPC mesoanalysis page. The red contours are low-level convergence, and you can see that the band of convection from radar coincides almost identically with the convergence band, which is a response to there being ascent along the surface front. Here's, now if we look at thermal advection at 850 millibars, the blue is actually cold advection. So from QG theory perspective, cold advection is actually coincides with descent. So it's obviously not this contributing factor on the larger scale It's sinking motion or isentropic downglide is not what's driving the convection. Same thing if you move to 700 millibars, there is some weak warm advection farther east. But again, what this says is that to this point, the QG response in the low levels is relatively weak or even hostile. But on the mesoscale, it's probably the frontal circulation. So if we look at that, this is the frontogenesis at 850. So the response to frontogenesis is to try to weaken the gradient. So you get a scent on the warm side. So if you look on the immediate warm half of these frontogenesis bands, that's where a scent should be going on. So at folk when you tend to see banded precipitation, that's a common response to frontogenesis, is parallel to the front. Now if you go aloft, 700 millibars, any frontogenetic response and the thermal advection was back to the west. So this slopes up to the west and northwest with height. So mostly what's focusing the convection back here, down here, are low-level mesoscale processes, the front itself. Large-scale, this is differential vorticity advection in the 700 to 400 millibar layer. Strong differential vorticity advection increasing with height, which is coincides with forcing for ascent. That's well behind the front, which is down here. So this is a typical configuration of a synoptic wave, a big baroclinic wave, strong cyclogenesis. The QG processes often linger behind in the mid-troposphere, and it's what you see going down on the mesoscale and the lower troposphere is what's driving the storm initiation. But remember the little speckly convection that I talked about here, that is close to the, this is another way of looking at the net effect of all the ascent. This is the 12-hour, 500 millibar height changes. These are very large changes of 180 to 210 meter height falls. So that means big changes going on in the atmosphere. And if you look right on the leading edge, that strong gradient of height falls, that's where the speckly convection was forming. And I think I have another graphic for that. And here's 500 heights of vorticity and water vapor. This is the leading edge of the strong vorticity gradient. And you can infer the strong vorticity advection is behind the squall line at the surface. Again, this is pretty typical. You don't see it all tucked in. And there's slope to these systems with height. Okay, so we get, when we look at something like that, or actually I'll make a point about this one. The stronger, deeper ascent was actually this, and again, we had strong winds with convection that did appear to be related to the large-scale forcing for ascent that moved into the west central and southwest Florida peninsula with near severe wind gusts, even though it was post-frontal. Okay, so let's look for the lift sources for elevated storms versus surface-based storms. We'll show another case to show how it varies. And in this, the summary is usually it's the mesoscale boundaries related to the surface-based storms, and the QG processes are more relevant for elevated convection. So we've got a front, pretty well defined across South Texas. This is a fairly recent case, very moist, dew points in the upper 60s near 70 in South Texas, right along the wind shift. So, and we actually have, if we look at this with height, 925 millibars, the thermal gradient and moisture gradients back to the northwest. We continue up at 850, it shifts northwestward. So you can see the slope of this front. It's at the surface down here by Corpus Christi, and by 850 millibars, it's over central Texas in the hill country. So we've got a slope frontal surface. This is, you almost always see it like this, especially in warm advection regimes. They'll slope, can be hundreds of miles off to the north or northeast or northwest. In this case, frontogenesis in the low levels, that's right along the front, so the response to that would be right on the wind shift, is where you would think that there could be ascent. Frontogenesis at 925, wow, this is displaced by at least 100 miles to the northwest, and if you go to 850 millibars, another 75 to 100 miles to the northwest, so you can see that the ascent, as you go higher in the atmosphere, slopes back to the northwest. And even at 700 millibars, that continues. So we've got a front that loosely slopes from South Texas all the way to Northwest Texas. And there's gradual ascent going along that whole corridor. Now, if we look at this in terms of QG theory, this would be the warm advection at 850 millibars. Now I put the radar on. Here are the thunderstorms trying to form right on the surface front. But this area of vertical motion associated with warm advection in northwest Texas is initiating elevated storms. And you notice it's more of a splotchy, there's just a broader area of precipitation. 700 millibars, if you look close, it's this orange area underneath this. Again, there's vertical motion associated with warm advection. Not so much, a little bit down in South Texas, but not so much. And then the differential vorticity advection, which we saw in the last case, here's the shortwave trough, little speed max coming out of southwest Texas. All of the differential vorticity advection and worm advection, the QG processes, are up here with this precipitation blob. Those were elevated thunderstorms, and then the more isolated point source storms down on the front are in South Texas with the frontal circulation itself near the surface. And then just another way to look at it, this is isentropic potential vorticity, another way to consider the QG process. So there's downstream, this is the same thing as differential cyclonic vorticity advection. So this is the large scale response with the elevated storms in northwest Texas, the mesoscale response to the surface front in South Texas. And again, most of the buoyancy at the surface is down here, so that makes this case easy. I'll show the soundings. This is the Corpus Christi sounding. It's very moist, unstable. There's enough vertical shear for organized storms. And in this case, it's not hard to see storms initiating because there's not much convective inhibition, a very deep moist layer. And the storms we're not worried about, severe storms to the northwest, because this is Del Rio back in that, up over the frontal surface, which this is the stable layer in the low levels. So the frontal surface slips all the way up to 850 millibars there. There's weak buoyancy, and we could get elevated thunderstorms, but generally non-severe back to the northwest. That's not always the case. Sometimes storms in these kind of regimes can produce large hail hundreds of miles to the north of a warm front, just depending on what the thermodynamic profiles look like. So again, we'll just summarize QG. That was illustrated through the two cases. We get gradual ascent over many hours. Warm advection and differential cyclonic vorticity advection are the primary contributors, but they're often not occurring dramatically at the time and location of surface-based storms. You can see some influence occasionally where the environment is set up. You see the source of gradual ascent that deepens the moist layer, but primarily the storms, especially out in the Great Plains, most of what you'll see will be mesoscale, and they are related to boundaries. And out here, the elevated storms would be primarily located in the zones of stronger quasi-geostrophic ascent. But again, it varies from case to case, and you have to look at the details.